Hey, what's up everyone, and welcome to this week's installment of the Fabricator Series Segments, where every single week I upload one more chapter, sometimes two, of how to build a tube chassis front end, which is demonstrated on this S13. So, if you are not subscribed already to the Fabricator Series YouTube channel, absolutely go down right now and push that button so you don't miss the next week's uploads. If you're not familiar with the Fabricator Series, head over right now or after this video to the Fabricator Series .com, and there you'll find the build blogs on how to build a tube chassis front end, where each week there will be another episode posted, and in there you can get onto the discussion of everything, ask questions, talk about it amongst everybody else, and all kinds of other good stuff. There's also a lot of great stuff for you to learn while you're over there. You can also check up on facebook.com/thefabricatorseries. There's always another upload, another update, something else going on, and I'm also a big fan of Instagram, so head over to Instagram at the.fabricator. Check all the information below here, and I'll have all of that there. If you need to get a hold of me, send a message, drop a comment, drop me an email, do whatever you gotta do, and I always try to get back to you. So without any further delay, here's this week's episode of How to Build a Tube Chassis Front End. Kind of getting the headlights just set in place. He wants to keep his pop-up headlights, and that's actually pretty cool. You don't see that actually happening too often with this car anymore. So, you know, I think it's kind of neat. So, got the headlight in place. Now, I'm not really concerned about it sitting in the exact spot that it needs to be in or anything like that. I'm just more concerned with it's there. So that way we can calculate and figure out where our tube is going to go. So this is almost entirely up to you to figure out. You need to figure out what your design is and where your tube wants to run. Now, I do know that I want my tube to follow this fender line here, dip down, go underneath the headlight, and then kind of bend its way into the side of the chassis rail. Not on top or underneath, just right into the side of the chassis rail. So I know that it's gonna come up roughly about 90 degrees from a certain point away from it, and then it's gonna have to be clocked and head up this way at some point to this angle here. So there are a couple of ways you can do this. You know that right off the get-go, it's gonna be 90 degrees from the lower chassis rail. You know that you want it to follow this line, so we'll take the protractor, hold it up here. It's exactly 10 degrees. So you know that the difference in that one is gonna have to be about an 80 degree angle or an 80 degree bend. It's going to have to be on this first part here, and then you'll know that it'll be another 90 at a certain distance, whichever, which you'll end up having to measure out. Or you can take do what I do. I use the cheater. This is the bend cheater, which has the notch that's cut out. It shows me where the beginning of the bend is in reference to the die where I stick it in there. It makes a great measuring point. It's already at 90 degrees, and then I'll stick it in here. You can hold it in place and say, yeah, this is where I want the bend to go. You know, you can just kind of play around with it, and that's a great way to do it. But I often run through my scrap pile or my cut pile, and I try to find other bends and similar sizes and whatnot that just came out of a previous build or whatnot. So in this case, this is a 70 degree bend with a pretty long leg on it, and it actually is very, very close to the correct length that I need, and we're kind of close to the bend angle that we need, so it's at 7 degrees. So I'm just going to put these two together here, and notice that it kind of creates the shape that I want. So as I stick these two together, kind of hold it in there, right about where I want it to be, I notice that I'm almost immediately just made the tube that I need to create. So I'm actually going to start by marking this out. And that right there will be my clocking reference. As the tube comes down, it actually sort of turns that way as the 90 is on it. So that's where I want to run with. And from this angle here, the way it looks, how I have the tube set up, it looks as if this distance here will actually do the trick Just by sticking the two together, I can measure these both out and figure out where each angle is, and then with the clocking reference, I'll be able to calculate the offset. So you can see that's actually kind of a pretty convenient method of doing it. Just grabbing two pieces from the cut pile or one piece in the cheater or whatnot, and you know, with any luck, I'll have this bent up correctly on the first round, and that tube will completely work. So that's a pretty easy method of getting the right design on the tubes you want to use, just by using other pieces and kind of sticking them together to figure it all out. So again, it's entirely up to your brain to figure out and compute your design to make sure that it is structurally sound and it does transfer and support the load according to what it needs to. And the rest is just up to trying to figure out, you know, which pieces work together and making it all come together correctly. So let's go get this bent up. I'm not gonna lie, it was actually convenient that this piece that I pulled out of the cut pile just happened to be the right size, so, and with the right angle on it already. So literally, I'm gonna run with this, and with the cheater, the way it's lined up and everything else like that, I'm just gonna go for it. I'm gonna see if I can get this tube to line up just right. Now, I do need a little excess on both sides, of course, so we'll get to measuring that out and figuring out where it needs to be and whatnot, but let's start with the distance between each bend, and or the distance between the start of each bend. Let's start there. So I know that the start of this bend, where it marks out in the die, and the point where the die actually contacts the tube and starts pressing in to bend it, is 3/4 of an inch. That's going to be about the exact same on this one. So at the point where I see that the die has made its mark on the tube, I'm going to subtract 3/4 of an inch, and bingo, there's the start of my bend. So I've already measured this out, but let's double check for the sake of making sure that, you know, we're thorough on this one and everything like that. That's 3/4 of an inch. So we'll start from the beginning of the first bend and to the start of the other bend. Looks like 4 1/4 inches. So 2 1/8 will be the center line that I'm going to reference. Now the tricky part here is going to be figuring out how much tube we need and where I'm going to start with that center line there. So I know that each bend at 90 degrees cost me about 8.5 inches worth of tubing. So what I'm actually going to do is start at about 12 inches of tubing, and that'll be the first line on my mark there. So 12 inches to the start of that, and then 4 1/4 inches away is going to be the other one. Then I'm going to add another 8 1/4 inches to this one, even though it's not really that much. And then we're going to take another measure here. That's like 17 inches right there. So we're going to go 25 inches of tubing post bend mark there. So that should be more than enough. So 12 inches here, 25 there, plus the 4 1/4 in the middle. We'll go in, we'll cut our tube up there, and we'll start marking out and measuring it. So the other bend that we need to make sure, we know that this one is 70 degrees. We know that this one is 90 degrees, but we need to make sure that we have the offset correct. So I'm going to set it up with the clocking line, and as soon as this stops moving, we'll know that we have an offset of, let's see if we get this line up just right, we have an offset of about 72 degrees. So I'm going to end up rounding that, you know, I'll probably round that down right into, we'll go down into 70 degree offset. So let's go get the tube cut, get it all put into the bender, and then all of this will make sense here in just a moment. So 25 inches plus 12 inches plus 4 inches makes 41 inches that we're going to use on our first tube. And it's going to be the same on the other side as well. So this is standard off the wall, regular plain old mild steel, 1.5 inch variety. Tubes marked out. And I'm going to take my seams and actually place them together. That way my references will come in correctly. So let's start with the first bend, the 90 degree bend. And I'm gonna start this off actually at 12 inches. I've got 12 inches on both tubes. And then from there, an inch and a quarter, or 4 1/4 inches away, which would be 16 and a quarter, will be the start of our second bend. So this first bend, I'm gonna note that it's on this side, is a 90 degree bend. And this bend, which I'm gonna note is on this side, will be a 70 degree bend. We also have a 70 degree offset, which as soon as we get it into the bender, we'll show you how to do that there. So let's get these ones cracking. Okay, so as we load up into the bender here, you can see my reference line here, which is the beginning or the start of the bend. And the start is always notated in this case with my bender at the beginning of the die. So that black line always starts at the beginning of the die. So obviously take a couple of minutes here, make sure that you have it set correctly, and that when you crank it down here, that line and that reference does not move. Okay, so I'll crank the tube down, set up my dial. This is a little bit of a preload here. Set my pointer up to zero. And this one will be 90 degrees. My 70 degree line is now referenced correctly on the bender. So I'll set that up to the beginning of the die. I'm just going to get this as straight as possible here. And now we'll get to measuring the offset. Okay, so this is where a lot of people get kind of crazy and wrapped up in this, and I try to explain to them that they don't really have to do that. But let's start by zeroing out our bender. It reads 0 degrees this way, which is great. It also reads 0 degrees going this way, which means our bender is completely level. Now it does look a little bit crooked in here, and that's probably the angle that I shoot out of the angle I have the camera set at right now. So, you know, it's just rest assured that it reads on the protractor correctly. So a lot of people get confused on the offset. Now, here's the thing. To make this really easy, you have two sides, and both sides are going to be identically bent. So, except the only difference is one direction is going to have to go bend left, and the other one's going to have to bend right. Which, when you stick it in the bender, that translates to one is going to be offset facing upward, the other is going to be offset facing downward at whatever degree they're at. So, I know that on the passenger side where we were just working on, my offset is going to have to face downward. I know the driver's side, the offset's going to have to face upward. Both of them are going to be down or up at 70 degrees. So with the line set on the beginning of my bend, I know that the passenger side's going to have to bend downward. I'm going to set this up 70 degrees. And then I'm going to crank this down. Now it's correctly offset. All we have to do, set my indicator to zero, start back. Here's tube number two. Start by getting our 90 degree on it. Let's line this up correctly in the bender. All right, so our last tube pointed downward for the passenger side, so this one going to be the opposite of it. It's gonna have to point upward for the driver's side. So let's set this up, and we'll turn this, clock it until we get to 70 degrees for our offset, which is right there. So we'll lock it down. We'll preload and set my dial to zero. And this bend will be 70 degrees. There we have it. Both tubes are identical length, identical bend, and opposing offset.